to Subrule 2 of Rule 95 would kick in and these independents would not be
actually
excluded.
I was reading the literal text of Article 51B. What is provided in that? Does it cater the need of the time which you have done?
My Lord, in this case, the primary question will be a two-step response to this, and that is how the case has also been made out. First is whether this is a party which the independents could have joined for the purposes of paragraph D of clause 6 of Article 51, and then if they could, whether this party then becomes or is entitled to those reserved seats or not. So this is the, in this order, these the questions have to be addressed in my respectful submission. If the court comes to the conclusion that yes, this is a party which they could have joined and therefore their status is no longer that of independence, then proviso to subrule 2 of Rule 95 would kick in and they will not be excluded. But if you come to the contrary conclusion to the contrary, then their status will then become that of independence and then they will have to be excluded. I will make one in during the course, I will make another submission which might then bring home the point.
Mr.
what Attorney, I'm trying to make.
What your emphasis is that exclusion of the independence with regard to the proviso, it caters both the positions, exclusion and inclusion. Inclusion is also under the proviso. If they join the party within prescribed period,
they get excluded.
And that joins such political party.
Yes, yes. And that's what the proviso also mirrors, actually. It gives effect to the proviso to clause paragraph D.
Exclusion and inclusion both.
Ji. My Lord, if I may now, my Lord,
Attorney General, I think we haven't addressed the basic question, and that is in the context of Article 51D. The edifice of Article 51D is the constitutional right of a political party. Now here, a political party has been excluded by the Election Commission. And that is the question. Now, this is would be a very grave constitutional violation committed by the Election Commission itself. So, as a constitutional highest court, it is not our obligation to correct this very serious, grave constitutional violation, because it goes to the root of democratic principles enshrined in this constitution, and it has virtually disenfranchised all those who voted for that political party.
My Lord, I intend to, and my Lord has raised this question, had raised this question yesterday. My last submission actually addresses this when I make submission on Article 187 also.
But can you come to the examples that you have given of the 2024 elections in your paper book? Because the impact is important to note and understand. So what you've shown on page 23?
No, Ladyship, if I may, this is the record which I had placed before you. For the purposes of the submission which I have made with respect to this record is only one. And when I make the other submissions, this will, my lady's question will then become relevant.
Are you going to go through this record?
Ji?
Are you going to go through this?
Ji, I will go through this record because in 2024 also, the independents have been excluded, independents including those who had joined
SIC. But you see here the number of independents are very large.
Gigi,
and so you can see
so.
The impact that it's Gigi, having
wo,
on your proportional representation.
Wo impact zara clear kar.
Wo main karunga, abhi main is pe aunga, abhi main ek abhi submission, I want to make a submission on Article 224.4, which deals with the vacancy of seats, the situation where seats have to remain vacant.
Actually, you see in the past, the independents are very few, so the question never arose and was not... It's a non-issue. Tha. In any case, also, you took out the independents because you can then divide the entire reserve seats. Nothing remains vacant. That's why the exclusion ki mathematics yehi hai. Exclude kar denge toh pura ho jayega, na? Sari seats puri ho jayenge.
Sir,
that's the only benefit, that you exclude the independents, so whole mein sare aa jayenge. Lekin the only problem with the current situation is that the tip towards independence being more, because nobody bothered challenging this earlier, nobody, it was a non-issue.
मैं
इसलिए इम्पैक्ट वाली बात अगर एक ऑप्टिकली हम देख लें क्या
जी जी मैं उस पे आना है मैंने आफ्टर मेकिंग दिस सबमिशन आई विल बी एड्रेसिंग दैट क्वेश्चन सर नाउ if my lords and your leadership may kindly turn to Article 224, I'd read out Clause 4 and then take you through the other provisions. The submission I wish to make, the point I wish to make, my lords and your leadership, is that the vacancy of seats envisaged for a very limited, narrow window under the Constitution gels in with the scheme provided in the Constitution itself, as also the law which is applicable in this case. Now, if I may kindly read out Clause 4 of Article 224 very quickly. When, except by dissolution of the National Assembly or a Provincial Assembly, a seat in any such assembly has become vacant, not later than 120 days before the term of that assembly is due to expire, an election to fill that fill the seat shall be held within 60 days from the occurrence of the vacancy.
Now, what, sir, what's relevance?
My lord, my submission is that the Constitution does not envisage vacancy of any seat. A seat must always be filled, particularly in the present circumstances also, where the seats are reserved for women and non-Muslims.
How does that work when a candidate of a reserved seat passes away or something?
Clause 6 kicks in. I'll read that out also. When a reserved seat for women or non-Muslims in the National Assembly or a Provincial Assembly falls vacant on account of death, resignation or disqualification of a member, it shall be filled by the next person in order of precedence from the party list of the candidates to be submitted to the Election Commission by the political party whose member has vacated such seat. Provided that, if at any time the party list is exhausted, the concerned political party may submit a name for any vacancy which may occur thereafter. Now, back to Clause 4. Now, there is a 120-day window, which is 120 days before the expiry of the term. If a seat falls vacant, Constitution says, don't hold elections. And one rationale is provided within this clause itself, which is, when read with Election Act, there is a 54-day election program also. So the 66th day is an absolute cutoff. Because after the 66th day, if the seat falls vacant, the elections cannot possibly be held because the 54-day election program cannot be seen through. There is another rationale to it also. If you may kindly turn to Article 222. I'll read out clauses B, C and F, but the opening part of it also. Subject to the Constitution, Majlis-e-Shura, Parliament may by law provide for B, the delimitation of constituencies by the Election Commission, including delimitation of constituencies of local government. C, the preparation of electoral rolls, the requirements as to residence in a constituency, the determination of objections pertaining to and the commencement of electoral rolls, and F, all other matters necessary for due constitution of the two houses, the Provincial Assembly and local governments. Now, the Constitution requires Election Commission to carry out these activities for the purposes of conducting elections and due constitution of the two houses. If I may take you to Section 14 of the Election Act.
इसमें क्या बताना था?
इसमें मैं ये बता रहा हूँ कि Election Act का Section 14 आप देखेंगे तो चार महीने के अंदर before the expiry of the term of the Assembly, the Election Commission is to complete the delimitation, prepare electoral rolls and so on and so forth, which is its duty under Clause F or 222 and the other provisions of the Constitution. So Section 14 अगर आप देखें Election Act का, so this timeline actually works with the timeline provided under Clause 4 of Article 224. जहाँ पे 120 days बताया था, तो साथ Election Act में भी बताया कि चार महीने expiry term की expiry से पहले ये सारी activity और ये सारा काम करना है Election Commission ने, जो 222 में बताया हुआ है. So when you read all of them in harmony, the constitutional command becomes very clear, which is that no seat can be left vacant but for what is provided under Clause 4 of Article 224. So Section 14, I can read out, but my lords may kindly note what I've submitted with regards to Section 14.
What do you say about Article 51.1, as my lord just Muni pointed out? Yahan pe zikr seats ka hai aur membership ka nahi hai.
My lords, my lords would see that Article 51 deals with a stage where the elections are being conducted, elections, it deals with the elections, it deals with the seats which are to be filled. Now, during the process, once the seats get filled, then they become members of the houses. So in the constitutional flow, a scheme of things, you start with 51, and then when you proceed, you are past 51, and the returned candidates are declared as such. They are administered oaths of the offices, they become members. So the interface is quite clear, sir, as far as my submission goes.
That perhaps you have reversed the sequence. I think the operative presumption of the constitution is that in any house or provincial assembly, no seat, reserved or otherwise, will be left vacant. That is the basis on which the constitution proceeds, to which, for example, Article 222(4) is an exception, that you must leave it vacant. Now, that presumption proceeds also on other presumptions. As my learned colleague Justice Masood Ali Shah pointed out, that the number of independents will be low. As you yourself said yesterday, that if there is a very, very large number of independents returned, there is something dysfunctional, something has gone out of kilter. Right? You said that yesterday.
My precise words were that people have rejected the political parties.
In the sense that we have a parliamentary democracy based on political parties.
Yeah.
So once you accept that as the basis of the constitutional framework insofar as we are presently concerned, then other things follow, then other clauses and provisions make sense. But here the very large number of independents, which you say is resulting in a vacancy of the reserved seats, and therefore the excess seats, as it were, go to the political parties and so on. It seems to me that that begs the question, where did that very large number of independents come from? Were they independents returned by the people, or were they independents, with all due respect to the Election Commission, created by the Election Commission on its faulty understanding of the Constitution, and in particular the judgment of the Supreme Court, which upheld their order? They said it meant this. It didn't say this, it didn't mean this at all. So you see, when we are in this realm, if this is the correct position, that this whole problem or issue is arising out of errors made by the Election Commission, then surely it is the, or is it not, the duty of the court, the Supreme Court, to the extent that it is able to do that, to correct that error, to rectify the problem, and if there are alternate pathways available, legally available, to choose the one that results in the error being rectified, and either for that problem, quote unquote, of reserved seats, the excess reserved seats going to political parties who are not really entitled to that because that tips the balance, that problem being disappeared because the reserved seats go to some political party to which is entitled, or maybe keeping the resultant vacancies to a minimum. I mean, seems to me surely that is the correct way to interpret and apply the Constitution.
My Lord,
rather than just saying no, the seats cannot lie vacant. No, I am sorry, I don't, with all due respect, look at it that way. I think the Constitution assumes that the seats will not lie vacant, and therefore in terms of 22.4 expressly creates a situation where the Constitution says, look, this is the working basis of the Constitution, but here the seat must lie vacant. Surely that's the better and more correct approach.
My Lord, I had begun my submissions by yesterday by stating that these reserve seats under 51(6) are to bring in women in such large numbers to the assemblies. It is for their empowerment. And the tool is the political party, or the vehicle is there, and the engine is the political party, and then there is a system which is provided, and that system excludes independence. So
no,
this
but,
is the flow.
But you see, it now, seems to me, just looking at jo aap abhi baat kar rahe hain, But then why have the system of proportional representation? Because it seems to me that when a general election especially takes place and general seats are contested by political parties, the mandate of the people is returned on that basis. Now you tip the balance. If you just take it up proportionally, right, in terms of the reserved seats, a political party wins 30% seats, it gets, leaving aside the proviso for a moment, it gets 30% of the reserved seat, another one wins one seat, so it gets nothing, and so on and so forth. That does not upset the mandate of the people. But if you, the approach that you take, that this is for this purpose, and therefore the seats cannot be left open, that actually tips the electoral mandate.